But all the states are allowed to be inserted. Okay, so let me do more precisely the following thing. Let me choose a physical state on the as a final state, psi fizz. And then I do any calculation I want, and choose the initial state here to be an arbitrary down state. By an arbitrary down state, I mean a state which has any value of k, not necessarily okay, a value such that k squared plus n squared is equal to 0. Some arbitrary down state. Okay? Now, because this state was exact for every value of k for which k squared plus n squared is not equal to 0, but every such calculation would be 0 for those k's that were not equal, that were not k squared plus n squared equal to 0. Okay? And therefore, if we did a calculation of this form, we'd get an answer that was proportional to a delta function. Could at best be proportional to a delta function. Now, if you in the situation of the point particle, unlike in string theory, you can actually use this formalism to do off-shell calculations. Okay? You can actually use this formalism to do calculations of correlation functions of operators that are not just S matrix elements. This is calculating field theory that you can actually do. And it's a property of field theory, okay, that all correlation functions of operators have certain reasonable analytic properties. In K-space, you have poles and cuts and various other structures, but you never have delta functions like this. This kind of analytic behavior in field theory correlators is just never present. In fact, the general theorems about the analytic structure of operators in the local quantum field theory, which disallows a singular behavior. Okay, so if you were to treat these states seriously, it doesn't. Well, these are the correct. If you were to treat these states seriously, they don't suffer from the problem that there's an ambiguity if you change the choice of gauge fixing. That's not the problem, yeah. The problem is that their amplitudes are, you would get answers for amplitudes that were very singular, that were not the answers of any that are allowed by general rules of quantum field theory. Okay? So in the situation where, what has happened? We know that we've got twice the space, we know that we've got twice the physical space in question. We know because we've done four different methods of quantizing the theory, so all of which are much more physical than this, and we know the limits. We've done this BRST quantization, we've got twice this physical Hilbert space. So one of the two must be disallowed. One of these has a strange property that if you use it to do calculations, you get answers that are of the form that are just not consistent with any sort of field theory behavior. Okay? So what we'll do is just be pragmatic, we'll throw away this guy. When we say the physical states of our system consist of up potential. Okay. So, I know this is not terribly satisfactory. I know this is not terribly satisfactory because it's not, you know, some systematic procedure we've used which works out down to the end to give you the answer. But, you know, that's basically really the way physics is. You know, what was the logic behind this BRST quantization? This BRST prescription that this was a physical Hilbert space? It was, well, it seems reasonable. Right? It seems like property we want. This is a property. But here, in this situation, we've got a subset of states that had all those reasonable requirements. That's also a reasonable, you know, thing to do. And it agrees with the right answer. The right answer meaning the answer that we get by other means of quantization. Okay? So, there may be a more formal way to understand why these states are, you know, not good states. But we're just going to be pragmatic. We're going to say that if we were to do a BRST quantization of this point particle, we would do it by throwing out these states. Okay, we would just by hand say that physical states are states that are annihilated by B on psi phase. This is equal to zero. So the end result of this whole procedure is a prescription. the fall point particle physical states obey, you know, are the cohomology of QDRS state plus obey the extra condition B on psi phi. I mean, this is the right answer. Well, at least this gives us the right spectrum. We know the right answer to the spectrum is with that in many different ways. And it's also these states that will give us reasonable answers for correlation functions. Just the answers that match not just what we know to be correct. In some cases, we know what is correct because we put in the right interactions with these point particles. We have discussed, by the way, how to do interacting point particles, which is an interesting problem, which we won't get into with these. In this format, we won't get into this concept. It reproduces the finite diagrams of quantum field theory. Right. The states that would have been exact, that were exact everywhere else, okay, but not exactly at k-square limit, k-square limit, you know, those states.
Okay, can you understand this way something like an I epsilon description? Okay, I have some problem.
You see, maybe what you're saying is rewording what I said. You know, the I epsilon prescription assumes that you've got reasonable behavior. These are things that are exactly zero, except at k squared plus x squared. You know, so even if put this in the language of quantum field theory, you wouldn't be able to do it. Now, these states just don't exist. It's a little bit of shit. Or they don't exist in the sense that they give you zero correlation, you know, zero amplitude with any physical process, exactly. You know, a little bit of shit. So, all the language of field theory, like an IS transition, will apply to these states.
Adding an imaginary particle mass, and then you can, you know, k square, if it is always there, this thing will never be, k square plus m square will never be zero. So in the way, all of these things are exact.
I see what you're saying. But yeah, maybe you could say that. I'm not sure. Okay,
but, please. If you do that, won't you spoil the first one? I mean, if we add a I epsilon to the mass, we'll be throwing out the down states, of course, but then what will happen to the up states?
The up states will have that
KK square plus X square difference. Slightly modified on-chain relationship, I'd say. I don't know. I think the way to treat this is just pragmatic. You know, in a situation where you can solve the theory in two different ways, one way is certainly correct, the second way was some ansatz. You know what the right answer is. You must do what you do. You see, what are we doing? We've got this enhanced Hilbert space that was not physical. Okay? And we want to find a way of cutting it down to the physical Hilbert space. We had a criterion from this BRST procedure, which was that whatever states we have must be in BRST cohomology. But we have no guarantee that space itself would not be bigger than the physical Hilbert space of interest. There's no guarantee anywhere in the game. We saw that, in this case, is bigger. Okay? Now, we want to do the extra cutting down that will get us our answers. We want to kill half of the states. We see, we have basically two options. We want to get rid of either this or this, but it would be a linear combination. Okay? And we see that these states are very funny properties. We just throw them away.
Generally, you know, you can't do that because they will be at an interval.
I completely agree. So,
it's an obvious that.
But at the level of a free theory,
apart from right.
At the level of the free theory, all we want is the Hilbert space. Well, the question will be when you get to an interact theory, when you use this to generate interactions, then is it a consistent thing to do? For instance. Do states of the first sort that you keep, would they try to mix with states of this sort? Would they try to produce these interactions? That's a very good question. That kind of thing we would have to address carefully in any situation where we use this. Okay, now the reason I've done this point particle so much in detail is that we're going to do something very similar in string theory. Okay, so in string theory, we will do a BRST quantization of our action, and we will put two conditions on physical states. The conditions will be first that they belong to BRST cohomology, and second that they be annihilated by the zero mode of the B field. Namely, the second condition will be B0 and field is equal to 0. For more or less the same reasons. Now, when we use this in string theory, we will perform a careful analysis of, for instance, issues like R states that are not annihilated by being produced and reduced and so on. There we will be very careful when we use it to study interactions. At the level of the free theory, of course, we will justify this more or less for the same reasons as here, but also again by a comparison with another way of computing the spectrum, the way we've already done in class. Life code. We have to get the same answer. Once again, we find double answer. Okay, so my answer to your question is that it's an ansatz, and one that we will be very careful to check for consistency. But I haven't seen a careful principled analysis of this ansatz beyond analytic properties, which we'll go through. Okay, I think we should stop this class here apart from questions. Okay, so what have we done in this class? Let me just summarize. What we did was to understand the BRST procedure in generality. We understood how you can in general construct a BRST charge, blah, blah, blah. And then we applied this to the point particle. Okay, we applied this to the point particle with that one extra prescription that was put in by hand, namely that the physical states in addition to BRST cohomology, being BRST cohomology annihilated by B. With one extra prescription, we recovered the Hilbert space that we know to be correct. Okay? Now, the next class, what we're going to do is to extend this analysis to string theory. Okay? We're going to write down the BRST charge on the worksheet of the string. And then, in the next class, we will begin a careful analysis of BRST cohomology of string theory. And the BRST cohomology together with this condition of B0 and annihilated states of string theory. What we will do is to prove what's called the no-host theorem of string theory. That is, we will prove that this cohomology coincides with the Hilbert space that we obtained through light code quantization in the previous class. Okay, this plus one or two more lectures will end the initial formal development. Which is essentially the boring part of the study of string theory. There's all this formalism we have to get through. Soon after that, we will start using this. We will start calculating scattering amplitudes. We try to do physics with this. That will be in about 3 weeks. Okay, so just again about schedules, we will have one more class this Friday, and then the next class will be on something like the 13th of December, the Wednesday of January. All right.